is for Nigel. We only want what's best for him. We're only making plans for Nigel. Nigel just needs that helping hand. And if young Nigel says he's happy, he must be happy, he must be happy, he must be happy in his world.
Of Nigel. Yeah. Put me on a retainer to write his memoirs of See, I Told You So. I jumped at the chance. He was the most captivating character I've ever met, and the singularly most creative man. For instance, his use of the word retainer. He never paid me a dime. It was worth it. It was worth it. Nigel changed my life.
You?
Well, fuck you.
Fuck.
That's all right, mate.
How fucked is that, huh?
Fuck. Fuck.
Fuck you.
Fuck you.
Do go on.
Bastard.
Bastard.
So basically they just fucked him.
They fucked him.
Basically they just fucked him.
Basically fucked him.
He didn't even get a kiss.
They basically fucked him.
They fucked him.
Fuck off, in fact.
Can't fuck it.
Do go on.
Fuck. Fuck off.
Oh, there you are.
Hi, I'm J. Marshall Craig. Like all good fiction, Remembering Nigel is based largely in some truths. And like I imagine all good science fiction is based in absurdity and chance, and that really is the making of the Remembering of Nigel. I have known Frank Housden for many years here in Los Angeles, and after he moved back to Australia, we lost touch for no other reason than just distance, you know, friends losing touch over distance. And in the spring of 2008, I have no reason for this. I contacted Frank. I sent him an email out of the blue, just wondering how he was. Nothing else to tell him. I just, you know, it was, how are you, buddy? And very, very quickly, I got an email back from Frank, which wasn't urgent, but it was quite striking how quickly Frank emailed me back. And he said, Jeff, thank God, I've been trying to get in touch with you. I've been thinking about you, wondering where you are. I'm just finishing off my latest film. I'm going to be in Los Angeles. I believe it was within about 14 days of when we had this email exchange. He said, I would really like to have you involved in this film. As I rekindled my friendship with Frank, I learned that, you know, we're not just kindred spirits, we're sort of like a karmic brothers. The all the time we spend together, whether it's on or off set, so informs me, and it has taught me a large degree about where Frank's artistry, how, not where Frank's artistry comes from, but how Frank manifests his own life into artistry. And we were blessed all along the way where We were either able to shoot just with, you know, verbal permission, or not even that, just an acknowledgement that, oh, something's cool is going on down there, we'll leave them alone. So there's a majesty and a magic in every moment I had in working with Frank on Remembering Nigel. And it's an experience unlike any other I've ever had. And I sure hope I get to have it again. And doubly so that I get to have the experience again with Frank Housen.
I think we were doing a retrospective at the Melbourne Underground Film Festival with Frank's work from Boulevard Films. And I said, wouldn't it be great to have something new? And Frank, I think, thought, well, I think I can get on top of that. And he had this idea that had been percolating. And so basically he created the first version of Nigel, which was a short. And we played it at MUFF. So hopefully it can be considered one of my small crimes against humanity, which is to inspire this film to be created. So it's been a great pleasure to have played it at MUFF and to see it develop from, I guess, a little 20-minute short to now like a 90-minute feature that has an incredible cast of Australian and American actors. So it's probably got the greatest cast of any Australian film ever. And he's also got one of the better casts for an American film.
Well, I had the good fortune of discovering Frank Housen, and he told me about this project that he was doing, mm-hmm. and asked if I would, you know, be involved in it, and it's just been absolutely just wonderful experience. Mm. Frank comes over from Australia, you know, at least every month or so to be doing filming on it. And we get to go out and laugh and get to hear the stories of the actors that he's working with. And he's just a brilliant, brilliant man. I experienced, and I'm not trying to be, you know, building this up and all like that, but he had a number of actors that were on set at the time. And each one of them was yelling in his ear saying that this is the way it should be done, and this is the way it should be done, and this is the way it should be done, and the cameraman and everyone saying this is the way it should be done. And what I noticed with Frank was that he actually listened to each and every person, took out the essence of what they wanted in that, and then created something new, not to placate them, but created something that was original and new, and everyone was satisfied, but him more so, because he created something, not to placate them, but created something new. And I was astounded at how he was able to go right to the heart of the situation. Mm-hmm. And I thought, this is really brilliant.
I'm with Bernard Fowler, who's just collaborated with Frank Housen on the new Frank Housen movie, which is called Remembering Nigel. Do you still recall that, or has those memories gone, Bernard?
You know, Mike, it's good sitting here talking to you about that, but that was the one thing that I asked them not to bring up, is that Nigel.
I know, Nigel is just, I mean, who could ever forget him?
We're gonna do that. This interview's over.
No, Nigel at all. I don't know Nigel. Nigel, where's Nigel?
No, where's Frank? Where's Frank? Nigel did this town like Hitler did Europe.
He's a lost Angelino in the city of light. He's gonna live forever if he don't die tonight.
Me ayudó a pagar para cruzar la frontera a mi familia y a todo el pueblo. Luego que llegamos a los Estados Unidos, nos llevó a su troca, llamó a la CIA y le declaró la guerra a los gringos. ¡Pinche loco! ¡Loco de la cabeza! ¡Nigel!
The thing I really like about Nigel is it didn't matter who you were, basically. It didn't matter whether you were Russell Crowe or whether you were the bloody, you know, the grip or the gaffer on the set. He treated you the same. He treated you with some respect. And he was a people person, basically. You know what I mean? A really nice guy. Unless, of course, he was in one of his moods. And then, of course, he treated everybody like shit. But that's just the way he was.
Nigel, words that come to mind are obnoxious. Asshole, unbelievable male groupie, hanger on, always there with a backstage pass somehow. He was a mystery.
You never knew what he was thinking. He would listen to you and go, yes, but you never quite knew what he was thinking or an answer to what you had asked him. So he was kind of a mysterious figure, you know? He kind of transformed, I think, he was maybe possibly channeling some very creative spirits at times. Because when by the time he left, he was resembling Bob Dylan.
You know, I would have liked to have called him a really good friend, but the truth is I really didn't know the guy.
When he died, he was rewriting the Gospels. He said there were holes in the plot. The Gospel, according to Nigel.
Scene 128, shot 4, take 1.
Action. One day, he wrote a rock opera, 2 plays, a movie, 15 songs, all in one night. I said, Nigel, get off the coke. Give the rest of the world a chance. He goes, that's a great line, and goes and does one. Or writes another fucking song, I don't know. I had to leave when he took up flamingo dancing. Flamingo, in the living room. There was like no room, pink shit everywhere. No room to do anything. All over, feathers, craziness, dancing, music, out. Cookie.
I'm afraid I have to run. I'm snowed under.
As another person, he could have been lovely.
I kind of wish I'd taken time to get to know him a bit more. Unfortunately, after I'd been granted the restraining order, that kind of wasn't an option.
Can you smoke on him? Spliff, you know. Codral cold tablets. How about some green tea? Roll that up with wheat. We'll smoke that and see how it goes. Mix it with toothpaste. We'll make a paste out of it, you know. Whack it with some water. We'd be like fucking Nigel then, won't we? All dead. Can I stop now?
There seemed to be too many people in the room. You know what I mean? Am I explaining myself? Well, he was up for it, but wrong timing. I was a blonde then, so many things got in our way. Then when I became successful, it was difficult for us to sit at the same table. Oh, this is not coming out right, is it?
You smell that? Somebody's got some weed, somebody's got some ganja. Spliff, do you want to find some for me? My PA's not here, could you do it? Hey, move, give me something. Clock's ticking.
Got him lots of interesting offers, but he turned them all down. Said he'd spiritually evolved past directing other people, and now his life was one long performance art. Used to hold court every Monday night at a place called The Joint. Used to get smashed and fall over to rapturous applause. Tell you the truth, I didn't get it.
I based one of my best-selling international children's books on him. Called it Monster. I think he took it as a compliment. That's how I remember him. That's him.
Bastard!
As another person, he could have been lovely.
No one should have to live through the kind of heartbreak that man endured. Has to do something to you.
Well, the first week of our affair was bliss, and then it descended straight to hell.
She bragged about sleeping with everyone in Hollywood. Even Lassie. Or was it Benji?
Our mannerisms changed. We'd walk around
Look at that bunch of puffers, basically. Your manners, oh, yes, I'd think of stuff.
You know, it's just something about the guy that no matter how many times he shafted you in every possible way, you still were his buddy.
He said he was a prince too, and I asked him what country, and he said, Eugenesia. I said, there is no such country. He said, oh, what the fuck happened to this country? Anyhow, the guy was totally nuts.
I'll remember the smell probably more than I'll remember anything else about Nigel. It was like a lemon. It was like a lemon and a, it was like a, it was a, it was a, it was a bad idea. It was the only time I smelled a bad idea, literally.
I wish I could just see him one more time and get that $50 back that he still owes me too.
All I can say is, quite frankly, and not to speak ill of the dead, good riddance.
They asked me to say a few words at the funeral, which is nice. I looked around at the congregated and I said, this is a typical Nigel production, isn't it? We're here, he's not. None of us know what the fuck we're doing.
Perhaps I invented him.
He gave us so much.
He gave us nothing.
Everything.
There'll never be another.
He was a pigment of my imagination.
Hello? Can't you see I'm in the middle of something?
He was such a good listener. In fact, I can't remember him ever saying anything. It makes you think, doesn't it?
Bollocks.
Nigel taught me this song once. It meant a great deal to him.
A kid that DeMiz has been working with, his name's Elijah Allen Blitz, and he's quite into hip-hop and making beats and things like that, and he's a fan of Eric Burdon and had read the book I wrote on Eric, Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood, and he told me that that was one of his favorite songs and asked me about it and, you know, quite willingly shared some stories about Eric and about the song and where the song came from. And Elijah said to me one day, said, would it be cool if I sampled the song and maybe came up with something for the soundtrack? And I said, well, yeah, sure, you know, it likely won't be in the film, but, you know, let's, you know, play with it, have some fun, see what we can come up with. And it's funny, Elijah was walking away from me, like literally from the table, and I stopped him. I said, oh, by the way, Elijah, if you do this, do me a favor, because there's an inside joke I have with Eric. A few years back, Eric played a private party at the Viper Room in Hollywood. And instead of singing the chorus, you know, Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood, Eric sang, Please Don't Let Me Die in Hollywood. So it's sort of a running joke that I have with Eric. So I mentioned this to Elijah, and I said, if you can, you know, work that in, it might be kind of fun, just, you know, a private joke between me and Eric. About 2 weeks went by, and Elijah showed up with a CD, and he said, oh, here's the song. He was kind of bashful and just left it and left the room. And I put it on, fully expecting, you know, a sampled hip-hop song, something about Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood. Well, Elijah came up basically with a rock, it's a brand new song that he wrote, entirely different lyrics, has nothing to do with Don't Let Me Be Misunderstood. The song is called Don't Let Me Die in Hollywood. Interestingly, in some manner, it mirrors part of the theme of Frank's film, of Remembering Nigel.
From all these people's opinions, I will be
Just lost little creatures trying to find a teacher in everyone else. Are you really listening or just waiting for your turn to speak? With your boxes of files and your big fake smiles, or the truth begins to leak. Now we may disagree, but I want this understood. Please don't let me die in Hollywood. Don't let me die in Hollywood. Don't let me die in Hollywood. Please don't let me die in Hollywood. Please, please don't let me die.
I heard he died of, you know what.
His liver fell out on the subway one night.
It was really just a boating accident. That's really all I know about the whole situation, really.
He was shot by a pirate.
Someone gave me one of Lionel's wines. Why not?
Anybody who lived there had to be crazy. Even the muggers were scared of him. Gangbangers crossed busy roads to get out of his way. Sorry, maybe I shouldn't do that.
Sorry, guys.
And we still want more. I mean, they actually thought he was one of the, you know, best regular customers. They asked me where he'd left, where he'd gone to.
Unfortunately, after I'd been granted the restraining order, that kind of wasn't a kind of
lists of every number one record since the beginning of time. Sorry, I'm going to have to start again.
After that, did you get another movie off? Did you get another movie? Oh, fuck. Sorry.
A lamb chop, root beer, I can never say no to that. I've lost my lines. Even the muggers were scared of him. They'd crossed the...
Nigel said, "Why are you killing a big titty dollar?" Rocky. Hey.
Sorry. Something. Oh, fuck!
It's all right,
man. Oh, fuck. Sorry, I'm... Oh, no, there we go. Let's go. Let's go. Sorry about this.
I had a prawn in my mouth when he looked up at me and said, "Do you ever feel, oh, fuck, that line?"
What's happened? I've forgotten my line. Shit.
Well, he had personal... sorry.
Come, that's it. Come.
You ready?
Yeah. You had everything.
Yeah?
Yeah, come.
Action.
Hated him.
standards.
He just... Oh, fuck.
What was it? That's right, mate.
He bought the most beautiful apartment in Toorak. Oh, fuck. What? Fuck it. Sorry, mate. But there you are. What's my next line? Sorry.
Sorry.
And action. They knew they had Nigel behind the eight ball, but he didn't have the funds to contest the charge. But finally and reluctantly, he had to plead guilty to the charge.
To the absurdity.
And one more. One more.
Okay. Should I continue from there?
Yeah, no, just go straight into it.
Okay. Oh man, look at those legs. Ooh. Ooh.
Oh yeah. Yeah, do that again today, and I just wish I could see him one more time.
Yeah.
And pause and then go and get that $50 back.
Yeah.
Okay.
Brilliant. You happy, love?
If you are.
Great. Really? These are brilliant.
Okay, good.
It's starring.
What about that one? That's for a man.
Right.
You want me to do it? Okay. He had multiple personalities, and personally, I didn't care for any of them. Oh, the first week of our affair was bliss, and then it went straight to hell. Just let me know when. It didn't get me.
Oh.
Okay, let me get my mind back where I was.
Right. Mark it.
Action.
Cut.
Mark it.
Scene. 162, shot 3, take 1. He did a cross-eyes again, though. Oh, my God, I didn't know you could do that.
Wow. Thank you. I hope you all had a good time. See you later.
He was becoming unstuck. In his logical mind, he knew that.
Beautiful. Excellent, mate. That was Rick Burchell's last shot on the film.
Hey! Yes!
He was fucking nuts.
You got something. You want more different ones?
Walk in, mate, and you just fake a heart attack. Get out of this joint. Everyone, run in! Oh, shit, what's happened?
Cole,
check it out.
Time to go.
Go! Quick, get out. You can all get out. Yeah, Cole, you try and get out now, too.
Trouble is, we don't fall in love with people, do we? We fall in love with who we want them to be.
That was beautiful. Was that last one beautiful or what? Did you like that last one?
Sure.
Sure. Yeah, I thought it was great.
Great.
I loved it.
Can I just have one more for me?
I forgot I was watching a movie then.
Okay. If you came over here like this.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be better.
I don't want some of the ballpark.
Just walk into that.
All right.
Yeah, that's cool.
Walk into that?
Yeah, just... No, that's fine.
Okay.
That's fine, yeah.
I get you going, doesn't it? Now, where were we?
Then, when I became successful, it was difficult for us to sit at the same table. This is not coming out right, is it?
Terrific. Let's do another one from the top and just move in a little closer.
Did you like the leg action?
Yes, loved it.
I'm sorry, did I say that too boisterous?
No, no.
All right, and...
Is this leg better or this leg to go this way on the camera? Which one?
I think that...
That one to go...
Just moved. I'm not seeing the legs anymore.
Oh.
No, we got the leg
shot. Oh, okay.
Okay, one and... More. Action, each poster. This is a bit of a hero shot. This is looking good, love. It's looking good.
I told you that word before.
Yes, we don't say heroine anymore. We're non-sexist. Here we go.
So bye. Filming.
You want that whole thing in one job? One bop? One thing?
Yes. We'll say it different times.
Yeah, and you can...
I'll get different
okay.
angles and... Okie doke. And in your own time, love, nice and conversational.
Oh, they did horrible things to poor Nigel. We can't rule out a right-wing government plot to silence his voice.
Fuck off, in fact.
Last burst just didn't look natural. Yeah, so, yeah. Keep it going and give it a good old burst, but then stop when he walks past. Okay?
Just kidding, yeah. Okay, and rolling and lock it.
Here we go.
Hey.
And
you know, who should I look right at the camera?
This camera, ignore this one totally.
Yes,
yeah.
As okay. though that's the...
You know, I actually like the guy, you know, but I'm...
Beautiful, beautiful, man, I love it. Can we go in for a tighter shot on this camera, mate?
Well, anyway, right?
Yeah, it's just...
It's more just, it's actually, to be honest, it's more just a safety. We've got the audio on both as well,
okay,
so it just
gotcha.
Gives us a margin for error, but I can't imagine using that because it's basically the same shot.
Okay.
Oh, we can use a wide one. Okay, and mark it.
And your own time, mate. Action.
Rolling. And a beautiful day in Los Angeles. Action.
And
for
us, and just make it your own.
Okay. And we fucking fast through the yet, you cunts. Oh, I've got a fucking tongue like lightning. Oh, she knows about that, don't you know? Oh, yes. What were you between those fucking legs, I tell you?
That was
brilliant.
Rhonda, if you want to do a quick kick, so we can...
Oh, I might do a kick, yeah. A bit of a Sharon Stone, actually.
Yes.
He said
I'll just
okay.
Kind of love
yeah.
some
yeah.
mic as it comes sailing over
that's
here.
Exactly.
That's it. That's how I'll do this one. He said it was okay to love something.
Yeah.
But you were damned if you love something too much.
Yes.
Go ahead. Action.
Yeah, that's good. That's a nice...
I mean, we started off with my buddy Taya Gill, and Taya came in.
I haven't met her.
You haven't met her?
No.
Oh, well, she's on parole now. I think we can probably hook
she's
up with her for
tall.
Dinner.
She's
very tall.
Yeah, she's
yes,
a tall
very tall.
Yeah. I like tall girls.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You like that one?
Yeah.
Oh, thanks, you guys.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just weird. It's like such a mystical experience right now. I swear to God, it really is. Like, I hear I'm with you guys, like it's really quite, I'm feeling overwhelmed.
Really?
Yeah, because
it's
a very it's a very emotional piece and
yeah.
it's, you know, I'm not sure if I'm relating to it the way that you're relating to
no,
it
no,
or,
no, no, it's
and I'm
beautiful.
Sweating up. And...
Okay, mark it.
You know, we were married for 11 months, 2 weeks, and 3 days. And those last 3 days were lovely.
But a great cascade of characters, from Taya through Taya.
Taya to that other girl.
Oh, that Oscar nominee, yeah.
Sally Kirkland.
Sally Kirkland.
Very
lovely.
Good.
Lovely, and a great painter.
Great painter.
No joke, a very, very excellent painter.
Yes, he painted my house.
He was the most romantic person I think I ever met. When you were kissed by Nigel, you knew you were kissed. And every time I look at the moon late at night, I think of Nigel.
The other guy, that really good guy.
Martin Landau.
Martin Landau is it in the film?
He's fabulous.
He's in the film.
He's fabulous.
He's fabulous, and that he's a good singer.
A very good singer. Mm. Yeah, though he doesn't sing in the film. And
doesn't sing in the film. Record. Unfortunately, he doesn't sing in the film. But he's a great singer.
Well, it sounded like a song when he said, "Get me the fuck out of here." It sounded like song. So like,
I remember one day I did something so stupid. I asked him to tell me his. He said something about his life. For 6 hours, he talked. He just talked and talked. And finally, it was 6 hours. And finally, I said, "Shut the fuck up!"
We've got Mark Rydell, Oscar.
Mark Rydell.
Oscar-winning director of Oscar-winning On Golden Pond.
Director.
On Golden Pond. Astounding.
Not this guy, but Mark Rydell.
Beautiful. One more, mate, but that's okay.
See, I don't even think you need it. Once you get to the second page, you know all your lines.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You just don't be afraid to rip on it and, you know the points.
Yeah, so. You know, he sent me a script that he wanted me to direct. And I liked it.
Tyler Hilton.
Interesting you bring that up.
Yes. Okay, I guess
Tyler Hilton.
I thought we were done. Tyler Hilton.
Tyler Hilton.
A good friend of mine. He came out.
He's a good friend of his.
Great kid, and he sort
great
of has that James Dean kind of
James
look.
James Dean sort of
so,
look.
He's we shot him up at the Griffith Observatory.
We shot him up, and they arrested us.
Do you want me to do all of these?
No,
I guess there's one more.
Whichever ones appeal to you.
Oh, okay.
Well, maybe that's a good one to do.
While we were all just going about our days, or maybe stuck in traffic or surfing the internet, he was dying. I think he was dying of loneliness. My opinion is, I think there were probably just way too many people in his life taking up space, you know?
And P.F. Sloan is in the film.
P.F. Sloan is in the film.
Not only contributed a song, but he's in the film, and actually he's done a magnificent job on the score.
He has. Fabulous. The legend. Haunting. The haunting legend.
The haunting.
Of P.F. Sloan.
Or the hunting. No, hunting. No.
Hunting. Hunting. No legend.
Yes, well, we had dinner every night for about 12 months. Had to. I mean, Nigel was sleeping on my couch.
We've got Ted. I'm glad you brought him up. We've got Ted Marklin.
He's fabulous in the film. He's fabulous, and of course, viewers will probably recognize him from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. He's the guy in the wheelchair in Cuckoo's Nest. And Ted's very funny.
He's
Ted is
very
funny.
Funny
in the film. Everybody's very funny in the film.
Yeah, very funny. You're not very funny. No.
Nigel had music in him. I know. I tried to beat it out of him.
What about Michael J. Pollard?
Brilliant.
Brilliant.
Yeah. Another Oscar nominee, Michael J. Pollard, and he's fabulous. He's very, very funny.
He's
in
very
the film.
Good in this.
Yes,
film.
He's.
Came to my attention that this guy was impersonating me. Who is this guy? He'd show up at Bonnie and Clyde shows and he'd be, you know, me. He'd start talking about my character like he was. It was him, you know. I said to myself, there's only one thing to do. I started impersonating him, you know. So it wasn't easy, but I did. Well, I got my face slapped by a lot of girls, and but now, you know, nowadays, now I can't tell whether I'm him or he's me.
Creed Bratton.
Creed Bratton from The Office.
I'd heard him play three notes, and I wet my pants.
One of the standouts, actually, though we rarely see him play a role like this, is John Savage.
John Savage, who I've worked with on many occasions.
Well, you had him in Flynn.
I had him in Flynn, and I had him in a film called Hunting.
Yeah, and you had him incarcerated.
I was in the bar with Nigel. We were having a good conversation, except we were drinking a bit too much. He got a little temperamental, and we'd both been drinking and having fun. And he told me my wife was bisexual and that she had arrived and she had gone off with the first AD, who was a woman. Well, you know, alcohol has that effect on people.
Yeah. And there's that, who could beget that other great actor in the film?
Apparently we can.
I've forgotten him.
I remember some of the scenes near the end of the film. We were shooting on the beach in Venice, California, during sunset, and it was absolutely remarkable to me. I mean, I wish for someday to, you know, have the talent to pull off some of the stuff Frank pulls off, but maybe even more than that, I'd like to have some of Frank's luck, because there were moments where a cameraman would actually be astounded and step away from the camera, leave it rolling, of course, but would step away and gesture at me because the birds had cooperated and flown in and out of frame as if we had entire wranglers behind the scenes with the birds on strings as if they were kites. They were perfectly choreographed, and it just happened. And you see it in the film. It's astounding. I've never seen anyone so gentle and yet so firmly in control of his vision. And by that I don't mean in an Orson Welles kind of overall way, which of course Frank does have, not to be too over-flattering, but Frank does have a specific vision in a moment.
Anyway, I'll be directing you now. Now, Camilla, what I want you to do is basically, you know, say your lines, and then, you know, then take a pause, and then say your lines, and then say your lines.
Okay. All right.
Have you got that?
So say the lines, take a pause. Say the lines, take a pause, and then say the lines.
Yeah, no, just do it out.
Okay.
Maybe stop, out and then just wander on, so.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, and I think this time you can be putting the makeup on and actually just occasionally talking back, like, you know.
So putting the makeup on, and then...
And like, just occasionally...
Where would you like me seated, Frank?
Just here?
Yeah, turning actually back?
Turning to the, like you're talking to the interviewer.
Okay. He told me he was born in the back of the tank.
Mary had a little lamb, do you know?
Yep.
Mary had a little lamb. Do you remember that one?
Yeah.
Can you read it, please?
Yeah. Okay. Mary had a little lamb. His fleece was as white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go.
Mate, open the door, buddy. That was very good, mate. You were really good. You were really good. Now, this time... Shut the door. Now, when you open the door, you gotta look at the director. When you open the door, be rubbing your eyes like you've just woken up, and then look up. Okay, and that'll stop you smiling too, because you'll be rubbing your eyes as you open the door, right? And then look up. All right, and then look and follow my hand. All right. Shut the door. Very good, mate. Very good. Let's just do one more at the end when you say, now this has been going on for so long that I don't know whether I'm him or he's me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just that part?
Yeah. No, we'll do the whole thing. Yeah.
The whole thing?
Because we can cut between each of them and get the best of the best.
The girl who's a bit crazy and on dope and all that dies. This beautiful girl dies in the film. So, they said, my God, this is a major model, and I mean, we lose the whole thing. So I said, well, shoot it while she's dead. Mm-hmm. But don't report it just yet. You've got a few hours, shoot her, and people won't know she's dead. See, you just prop her up. So they propped her up, and in all positions, and they shot the film. And it was just very, very funny. It's outrageous.
Like you said?
First week of our affair was bliss,
and
it went straight to hell.
Okay. All right. First week of our affair was bliss, and it went straight to hell. Okay.
fell straight from another body.
Am I looking at that camera or just that one? Okay. So I'm looking in the camera, right? Looking in the camera?
Yeah.
Okay. Where am I supposed to be looking?
Just straight in the camera.
Straight
like
in the camera.
Like you're being interviewed.
Okay.
You run along the ladder.
Shut up. Shut your mouth. As if.
Fire the city.
I've worked with the best, and Nigel was not one of them.
I could grab your hand as the music swells, but I'm just hustling around, and I'm not Orson Welles.
What is your fondest memory of the making of Nigel, the film?
Working with that that music guy, what's his name?
Jason Young.
Jerry Jeff Walden. Was, you know, that music guy was incredible. And, you know, some of my happiest moments were being in the studio with him saying, what the fuck are you doing?
Well, really how it all started was kind of a surprise to me because I had no idea what they were doing. Frank was over for dinner one night and Jeff kind of came in with a camera and just said, you know, just be yourself and say this or do this. And the next thing I know, I'm in a movie with Martin Landau, Sally Kirkland, and Eric Burden. And it was just a really good time. And I really had no idea what the heck they were doing until the music started coming into it. And they're like, you know, do you want to do this? Do you want to do this? And the next thing I know, I see a couple clips and I'm like, wait a minute, this is kind of cool. So it really kind of just got me involved. It was, you know, a natural momentum thing that just kind of carried away. And you know what's crazy about it, though? It was really crazy to see how obsessed Frank was. Because like every night, like he'd walk up to the hat, you know, and like look at it, and I'd see him kind of sitting there, and then before you know it, he'd have it on, and he'd be walking around, and it'd be really late, and I mean, I don't know what he was drinking. I think it was like absinthe or something. Like, I mean, I don't know how he got it, but he kind of was walking around, and I kind of saw him like bumping into the wall, like, you know, those little toys that just kind of like keep bumping into a wall, but I don't know. Maybe wardrobe got mad because it kept bending the hat, but I don't know. It's really weird. Maybe that's why he always had a bloody nose. You know, P.F. Sloan came up with this song, Ginger Street, which was a beautiful song. And P.F. Sloan is a beautiful person, great guy. And what was really cool about all of it, really, was you had these legends like Eric Burden working with Elijah. You had P.F. Sloan working with Becca. And not just that, but also No Love This Year that Frank wrote that was beautiful, too. But Ginger Street especially was really cool to see to come together because it was kind of the bridge record into No Love This Year, where she really found her voice. And when she started off with Ginger Street, you know, we did a couple different takes and I kept pushing her and we all just kept pushing her and pushing her. And I wanted to see how far we could really push her because I knew No Love This Year would be a real task for her and make it real sultry and real, real, real cool. And she really pulled a vibe out of it. And, you know, once again, going to dinner with P.F. Sloan and Eric Burden at Dan Tana's with everybody there and watching Elijah interact with them and everybody just kind of showing a brotherly bond and just kind of sharing information. And Eric, who's just a great guy, was just telling us so many stories of Jimi Hendrix and how he made it and the Animals and all of that. And it was really, really cool to see it all come together.
Let's see. So when I first start, I don't know what the chord I'm hitting the C, but it just doesn't sound like. I don't know if that sounds good. I don't know how to make it sound. Maybe you start coming in there, like with the beat. So I don't know. Did I do that like four times or something? Thank you.
I remember the last time I saw him. It was in a bad part of town, where all the hobos congregate. I was just walking past, and I looked up into the watery pools of his eyes. Well, I. And that was where it ended. He'd lost everything, even the will to go on. We never exchanged a word, just a look. I mean, what could you say? He looked like a man who had seen too much, and he didn't want to see any more. But there was a look of contentment. Oh, that look. It haunts me to this day.
Streets are dark, shadows lonely, life feels cold and so unfriendly. Defending myself from uncomprehending people, I thought I knew. Mocking, joking like the dead do. Maiming, blaming all except themselves. Living in strange minds, desperate lives, and the ignorance we all cling to.
Ginger Street.
there's a magic. Remembering Nigel is magic. And I think every film fan should be, you know, so happy that we've been blessed that that Frank was allowed to channel his own true life experiences, have the vision to shape those channeled experiences into a coherent film, make fun of himself, make us laugh, make us cry, and ultimately probably the greatest gift I've ever seen in an artist or read in an artist, you know, my favorite author, my favorite filmmaker, my favorite musician, the gift to make us think about ourselves through those laughters, through those tears, through that that shared experience, and it's a gift, and it's really been an honor to work with Frank on Nigel.
Night after night, I stumble and fall through my weary world till I hear you call. You say, come back, all is forgiven. You smile away my fears, you're my reason for living. Good night. My heart's on the mend, sleep tight. I call you my one true friend, wherever you are. Good night, sleep tight. Day follows night to catch me. To find me in shadows where lovers love no one. They cry, go home, all is forgiven. I brush away the years to that summer of living. Good night, sweet prince on the run. Could have made you stay, but what to say, what to say, what could I say? If face to face, when I see you there, that fantasy fades.